Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you sat through a week of jury selection to get to the point where we can tell you what this case is about. While we took the time to deal with each of the points that were important in jury selection and ask you a lot of different questions, we're at the beginning of the case, so I can tell you about the beginning of the case. On April 18th of 2016, in the South Gwen Cherry housing complex in the city of Miami, Florida, a man was standing and he was approached by several individuals over time. The man's name was Terrell Washington, and in the course of this evening, folks came to talk to him and they seemed upset. Something wasn't right, and more people came to talk to him. There came a point in time when he was taken, walked back, and shot to death. He was killed. The evidence you're going to see in the course of that shooting, there was a return of fire, gunfire going back and forth. It was tragic. In the course of this case, you're going to hear about members of the City of Miami Police Department who went to try and help, tried to investigate Mr. Washington's death. While that investigation was going, a few days later, on May 5th of 2016, at the South Gwen Cherry Housing Project, another man was standing. And once again, that man was approached. And once again, that man was shot to death. And once again, City of Miami Police Department responded to the scene, tried to find out what happened. But when they saw these two deaths together, they began to look beyond just what was right in front of them. They began to look what was all around them. And as they looked, they realized these two events. These aren't just ships passing in the night without anything to do with each other. We need to look further. We need to do more. And when they looked, they found. And they found that the South Gwen Cherry housing complex wasn't just a home to a lot of good, hardworking, decent people that lived there. It was home to something else as well. It was home to a criminal organization, a gang, criminal enterprise under the law that we found that brings you to court today. Members of the City of Miami Police Department reached out to federal authorities to help them investigate this criminal enterprise, to look back and see what had been known to what was happening now. And what they found was that this criminal organization had been in existence since at least the year 2000 to 2017. The South Gwen Cherry housing complex, with all of its good people that lived inside of it, was also hosting something else, a group of men who banded together to make money through criminal activities, a group of people who worked together year after year, crime after crime, to make sure that crime would pay. Members of the organization were identified through this investigation, which brings the indictment here to you today for those members linked to the South Gwen Cherry housing complex, sometimes referred to as Smackville, sometimes referred to as the base. These individuals, they all didn't live there, but they're all tied there. They were all tied there through their interest in making illegal money. This organization existed for years, and it went from one administration, and when someone fell out of favor, got in trouble, someone picked up the baton and went on to make more money so that it could continue to grow despite any interference. The organization did things like normal business would do. They would find people who maybe they didn't get along with, and when it made financial sense to them, they would pair up. They would link together. So instead of fighting, they could make money. They developed sources of supply. They found people who would give them drugs, who would give them guns, and they ran, effectively, a criminal family business who had a culture of knowingly acting, reacting, operating as second nature. They operated with that second nature to make this money through two primary means that you're going to see in this trial. They made money through drug dealing, drug trafficking. And you're going to hear about drug trafficking in the course of drugs like crack cocaine, cocaine powder, marijuana. And the conspiracy that was a big part of the money-making drive for the organization had folks that would do different things. Some were connected to crack cocaine. Some were connected to marijuana. But all working hand in glove for each other to make money, to preserve the base, to preserve Smackville, to make sure that the organization was successful. You're going to learn and see from the witness stand that there were some members of the organization who also, through their close bonds and ties, would band together to make money through violence. Crimes like robbery. Crimes like robbery where drugs would be stolen. Personal property of innocent citizens. Businesses would be targeted. When we talk about drug trafficking, this is what you're going to see. This is what they did. As a business, they had a salesman, and this illegal family business would rotate from time to time. Someone would be the hand-to-hand drug seller, sometimes referred to as a bomb man, and then someone might pick up the role and say, without even thinking about it, just be their lookout, a watch out. One person here, selling the drugs. One person here in a position to tell them police, rival, watch out, red alert. In addition to people who might just be looking, riding on bicycles, watching out, there are people who are armed and prepared to protect the organization. There are people who are selling drugs who, if they got robbed or shot at over drugs, were not in a position to call the police for help because they're working in illegal business. So they had individuals who took up the role instinctively of being the security. Of course, every piece of drug that came into this business came from a supplier, and every gun from someone who was there to lend that firearm so that it could be used. You'll also understand and hear from the case that there were lieutenants or deputies, people whose job would be there to oversee the family business, to collect the money when there was an opportunity to distribute drugs or collect money. Someone would be there, and sometimes that role would be filled by an individual who was the lieutenant or LT, or that might be filled by the boss himself, whoever that boss was in the course of the conspiracy. Now, I referred to you that there were violent crimes, robberies of people, legal businesses, places like Metro PCS, places like a food spot, and then drug dealers who had illegal product because that's better than paying a good price than paying no price. So then they can sell rivals or opposition, sometimes referred to as ops, to sell their drugs with no payment. Straight profit for the group. The group existed because it was illegal, through violence. It was its primary means of protecting itself. They do it for money. They would take from people whose things they wanted. They do it to make sure that the base, Smackville, was theirs, could not be taken. They do it to retaliate against people who are rivals, cooperating witnesses, disloyal members. People in these situations, in the course of this case, you're going to meet. You're going to meet these victims, and all of these individuals instinctively working together were the organization from drug seller to lookout to an enforcer, to lieutenant, to leaders. That takes us to the defendants in this case. Mario Rodriguez. You're going to receive evidence about Mr. Rodriguez's role, and you're going to see the pictures of Mr. Rodriguez's activities, see him claiming the organization. An organization with many names, but one unit. You will see him claim the Dubside Blood Family, DSBF. You will read him participating in the organization. You will see the evidence collected from Mr. Rodriguez during the course of this case. Guns, ammunition, scales, money counters, evidence from Mario Rodriguez. And you're going to see his role facilitating, helping, assisting this organization as a committed association and partner. Through the course of this evidence, you will also see the role of Mr. Torivis Reginald Ingram, goes by the name Mullet in the evidence. What you're going to see there, Mr. Mullet participating in the organization. You're going to see pictures of Mr. Mullet. You're going to see the communications between defendants about him, working together, who is going to do what, and you're going to see the physical evidence about Torivis Ingram. Not just the pictures, but you're going to see firearms. You're going to see narcotics, drugs, that were recovered during this investigation directly involving him. And you're going to hear witness testimony about his role in the organization. You're also going to meet a defendant by the name of Samuel Hayes. Mr. Hayes's evidence will come into you in the same way. Pieces of social media, recovered store surveillance from robberies he participated in, and you're going to read his participation in the group. There wasn't just a robbery happening, but you're going to read his explanations of what he's doing and why he's a part of it. The evidence will also introduce to you Mr. Daniel Jones. The evidence in this case, you'll meet Mr. Jones and you'll meet his role in the organization through evidence such as recovered social media videos. Mr. Jones's cellular phone and his text communications with members of the organization. You're going to hear witness testimony about Mr. Jones and you're going to hear about and read about him being a point of contact for this organization, for drugs, a scale, all in black and white, color pictures. You're going to see him on video. Likewise, you're going to be introduced to a defendant, Reginald Graham, Reggie, another worker in the organization, another person communicating with members of the group about narcotics, re-upping for narcotics, in possession of firearms, participating in the acts of this enterprise, of this gang, of this criminal organization. You're going to see that yourself, and you're also going to hear from the witnesses who saw it themselves, like you will for each of these defendants. You'll likewise meet another worker in the organization, Mr. Michael Walker. The evidence for Mr. Walker will be in the form of witness testimony. Individuals who saw him, like many of the defendants, participating in the acts of the enterprise, participating in the acts of this organization, selling drugs, his own words, communicating about drugs, communicating about firearms, communicating with other defendants. You're going to see this yourself. Likewise, you're going to be introduced to defendant Levi Bryant through the testimony of witnesses about him, his activities selling narcotics. You're going to hear Mr. Levi Bryant in the course of this case through recordings that were captured by the government and its law enforcement partners. You're going to hear Mr. Levi Bryant is a person who was there, who assisted, who was part of the team, a team of individuals working together to make money through crime. Then you're going to meet Mr. Curtis Bryant. The evidence about Curtis Bryant. Through Mr. Curtis Bryant, you're going to hear about a very powerful episode that captures one of the most sad parts of this case. You're going to hear about an event on March 24th of 2015 when members of this organization were at their base at Smackville and they were attacked by a rival organization. Came over, started shooting at them. The consequence of what the evidence shows this enterprise brought upon. One organization fighting with another organization. Shots going off, and when those people had finished shooting in South Gwencherry because they were at war with the organization, they were trying to flee and run away. You're going to receive the evidence about Mr. Curtis Bryant taking the opportunity as one of those individuals was running away. The person he thought was involved. He popped out of his apartment and shot this person, a victim by the name of Richard Hallman, in the back, and killed him because he could. Because he didn't want to call the police. Because this wasn't a police matter. Because when you read Mr. Curtis Bryant's Facebook account, this wasn't a police matter because they are living, in his words, in a war zone. And all the people around them, as a result, are in the war zone. Those are his words. And you're going to see what Mr. Bryant felt about Mr. Hallman. In a published photo of his body in a casket, people laughing, joking, posting his homicide flyer for the people to have at it because he was a casualty of war in the eyes of Mr. Curtis Bryant. Mr. Curtis Bryant took his role as an up-and-coming member at this stage of time, as someone who was a lieutenant, someone who wanted to be somebody in this organization seriously. So he put his life on the line. And you're going to see that on April 18th of 2016, when Terrell Washington is about to be slain, it's Mr. Curtis Bryant, as part of the group, is walking towards him. This was serious to him. This is important to them because this was their livelihood. This was their family. The evidence will also take you to defendant Jermaine Bryant. In the course of that evidence, you will see what you will read and what you will receive from witness testimony. Mr. Jermaine Bryant, a person, self-identified, identified as others as one of the principal leaders of the group. He was one of the top smackers from Smackville, self-described member of the organization as a capo or captain. Self-identified on Facebook, blatant, out in the open and obvious, using some of the handles that the organization was using at that time. RNS, DSBF, Capo, that's what he was. The evidence will show, and through the witness testimony, that he lived up to that. He rose from the beginnings of the organization as a seller from the year 2000, as early, beginning in the 2000s, a person by the name of Ike Thompson, who ran the South Gwencherrys for a long period of time, and there came a point in time when there was new management. A transition took place and he evolved. He continued to evolve and became a supplier for the group. You're going to read that and you're going to hear that. Then you get Mr. Antonio Glass. Mr. Antonio Glass, at the beginning of this investigation when they're starting to focus on the group, was the leader when this group was investigated. Mr. Antonio Glass's time with the organization started out small and elevated from a salesman to the point where he was in the position to take over the group with the assistance of others, and he led it. And you're going to hear the words and you're going to read the words. Self-identified leader of the group, ambiguously saying he was the boss. And as the boss, he was responsible. He would go and collect money, and he would go at times find people's narcotics, find people's drugs, collect and run South Gwencherry like a little kingdom. And he got there on the back of another murder. You're going to hear on November 6th of 2010, a person by the name of Pooh Johnson was a problem for this enterprise, a problem for this organization. He was robbing and stealing and being a pest, doing bad things. And it came to Mr. Glass to do something about it. It came to Mr. Glass to step up for the project and end that problem. And he did. The evidence you're going to receive, Mr. Glass shot Pooh Johnson dead. And you're going to receive testimony of him claiming it, bragging about it, and using it to elevate his status in the organization. You're going to hear, you're going to see, Repeated references by Mr. Glass about his willingness to kill. That is what kept him on top.